So welcome to the first faculty seminar of the academic session. I think it's a bit of a commentary of the state of things that although this is a faculty seminar, we have very few faculty members here and we have a lot of students. And I know that the students are here not out of loyalty for Harini, but because they want to learn how a very good scholar and a very good teacher does certain things, right? I'm also happy that you've been able to make it because the time is 9:30 and you know what the city is like, what the traffic is like. So I'm sure you have some enthusiasm for the speaker and the subject if you've made it to this seminar. I just want to add one more thing before Himanshu introduces Harini, that we've been compelled by circumstance to hold the faculty seminar at 9:30 a.m. Ideally, I would like to hold it in prime time. And prime time in college, in university, is 11 a.m. But unfortunately, the heads of various things tell us that they have meetings, you see, and meetings have to be organized. And sometimes in every organization, things that are urgent but not important take precedence over things that are really important. So, you know, these meetings that are urgent have to happen at 11 or some such thing, and therefore seminars can't happen at 11. They have to happen at 9:30. But this is the circumstance in which we hold it at 9:30. We'll try and move it to 11 if we can, but bear with us until then and keep your enthusiasm alive and do come to them even at 9:30. With these words, I'll give it to Himanshu because Himanshu knows Harini's work much better than I do. And I would call upon him to introduce her. Thanks.
Harini, as you all know, is an illustrious researcher. She has worked a lot on urban ecology, urban commons. She worked a lot with a well-known urban ecology researcher called Eleanor Ostrom, and has also been awarded with an award that's named after Eleanor Ostrom. Her work has been around the city of Bangalore. She says in the recently released book, which is the second from her, amongst list of many, many publications, the other book is about reforesting landscape, which is also about the forest and urban areas. And this book is called City, Nature in the City, Bengaluru, Past, Present and Future. And I was reading this book, not quite in detail, in depth, but the book speaks to historians. The book speaks to ecological historians and environmental historians. The book also speaks to that genre which has found attraction a lot amongst readers called books on cities. Books on Ahmedabad, there would be a book on Lahore. This book is again something like that. And if you look at her bibliography, she draws a lot from that genre as well, not merely from biological scientists, not merely from history. And when she deals in several chapters about the historical monuments and the archives, there also you can see that she travels beyond merely biological sciences and all. And I was looking at chapters where she reports her research findings, it's again abstract style. So when you read the book, you know that you will have to chase those footnotes and references again. The entire chapter would not be here. So for example, she would have something about home gardens in slums in Bengaluru. You will have to then pick up that paper and read it. So with these words, I invite Harini to give us the faculty seminar talk. And I hope that this sort of audience and the numbers that you have shown us remains throughout the semester as we progress. Thank you.
So first of all, thank you so much to Himanshu and to Anil for this very nice invitation to give the first, I mean, it's an honor to start, I think, this series of this semester. I see some familiar faces, some of you whom I taught last year, many I think whom I'm assuming are from this batch. I just want to have a quick question before I ask. How many of you have been in Bangalore for, let's say, at least 2 years? Okay. So I hope this talk, for those of you who are from Bangalore or have been here for 2 years or more, tells you more about the city. And I hope for those of you who don't know the city also, it introduces you to a different flavor of nature in Bangalore and maybe helps you think about other cities that you've been in different times and grown up in. So let's start with this, and let me explain a bit about why I'm calling urbanization a new frontier for conservation, because they might seem like two different things, no? Cities, urban areas, and conservation. You think of conservation as forests and deep jungles and a lot of wildlife. Why am I saying urbanization is a new frontier for conservation? This is a nightlight satellite image of the world. And you can see large, oh, can we put off the lights? Thanks, Gayatri. This light needs to go off. The front light needs to go off. The back ones can stay. You can see this? Okay. Yeah, so this is night light satellite image of the world. And you can see, I mean, where are the lights? Lights are where there are people, but the lights are where there are urban people largely, because people in rural areas don't switch on lights. Half the time they don't have electricity, and they don't have the habit that we do in cities of switching on our lights everywhere and leaving them on all night. So this is a very good map of urbanization globally, and you can see, I mean, apart from, of course, North America, Europe, where you expect places to be lit up, look at India, look at China. And you know that these are areas that are experiencing a massive urban transition. Okay, so in India, the world itself is 50% urban, and there are projections that say that it'll be 75% urban by 2050. In India, projections variously between 2045 and 2055, we should be more than a 50% urban country. And China obviously is accelerating far more. So where are these cities coming from? If you look at the growth of cities, and this is based on UN data from 1990 to 2014, the growth of cities is really dominated by Asia. Very clear, that's where. And new cities are growing. I think Africa will be the new transition after Asia, but right now Asia represents the real front of this urban transition. And if you look at where all the fastest growing cities are, not the largest, but the fastest growing cities, they're all in Asia, largely, right? Asia already has half the world's urban population. And this, if you look at, is sort of, I mean, this is where we are. That line tells you where we are right now. And this is going to more or less plateau off at this stage, where North America and Europe's urban population of the world, their share of the urban population is decreasing, while Asia is going to stay stable at 50, 60%. And then Latin America and Africa will take over the rest. So what does this all tell us? That we're going to have a new kind of an urban future, an urban future where the cities that we know of, think of as iconic cities, you know, Chicago or New York or these big American cities or big European cities, London or Switzerland or wherever, you know, are not going to be the cities of the future. The cities of the future will be cities like Bangalore, cities like Delhi, cities like Jakarta, cities like Dhaka, which will really be the future of, and we know very little about these cities, because most of our studies on cities have been in these North American, European, or maybe places like Hong Kong or Singapore, you know, a few cities in Asia that are well known. Now, what do we know about the future of nature in these cities? So do we know enough about ecology and conservation? First of all, to begin with, we know very little about these cities, how they're growing, why they're growing, where they're growing, what are the challenges for people. In terms of ecology, in terms of nature, we know very little. And if we are moving, as I said, to a world where 75% of the world lives in cities, we can't think about conservation as a rural problem or as a rural challenge. It is an urban challenge. And the second part of it is, if we're looking at where the generations of the future will come from, So for instance, let's take a call. For those of you students here, how many of you grew up in cities? So a large share of you, right? And if you look at this, if you're thinking of the fact that 50% will come from cities in India, let's say by 2045, 2055, that means the share of children coming from cities is going to grow proportionately larger. And if you're thinking of a world where you need nature to survive, we all know that you can't have a world without its forest, without its water, without its other aspects of nature. For children who grow up in cities and who have no knowledge of nature except for what they see in cities, they will have no understanding of how to deal with this world, how to conserve this world, how to protect it more holistically. So we must need nature in cities, not just because most of us will be in cities, but because it promotes an ethic of thinking about the world as an integrated system, which you tend to lose when you grow up in a city which has, you know, nothing natural around you. So this, and questions like this, was sort of what prompted my background of research on Bangalore. And I'll start with a little bit of a personal narrative before I move into the story of the city itself. This is a program that, so I'm from Bangalore and grew up here, spent most of my life here, apart from short periods outside. And this was a program of research that I initiated in 2007. Until then, I'd worked largely outside cities. So and really most of urban ecology has not, most of ecology has not focused on cities historically. People have been looking at forests and more rural areas. So we started a program in 2007 with a diversity of students, a lot of undergraduate students, some school students, some master students, looking at land uses across the city and looking at a long time frame from 6th century all the way to now. And using a lot of different approaches because we wanted to understand the city holistically. So some remote sensing and GIS, spatial mapping approaches, some oral histories, talking to people, some looking at archival digging, some biodiversity studies, stories of people and places. As I said, this is very different from what I did before. So from 1993, which is really where I started my research career, I've been looking at forests and I started working on the Western Ghats. Then I looked at central India, looked at areas in Nepal, some areas in Guatemala, Honduras, different parts of the US. So forests across the world, and as Himanshu was saying, reforesting landscapes was one of my big areas of interest, looking at not just when do forests disappear, but also when do people protect them and when do they actually survive and thrive. People can be positive agents of change and negative agents of change, and I think too often we just discuss it as though people associate are an inevitable reason for nature to disappear. But people can also be positive forces for change, and which is why all of you are here in these programs of the university. So the city focus came, city study came with the same focus. When does nature thrive in cities and when does nature disappear in cities? And how is this related to people being in cities? And my city focus did not actually start with research. So that's why my city research is very different from my forest research. I came to research in the city as a personal story of engagement. So this is a lake near my house. Started when we, and I moved to this area in 2006. It was the picture that you see above, 2005, 2006. Swampy, marshy, full of sewage, some trees growing in there, some dead pig carcasses, you know, people. So the area in the back was taken over. It was very unsafe for people to walk around in the evenings. A lot of trash dumped. That lake, over time, we had a community-led restoration. So there was a group of people in the area that started working on the lake and started contacting me. At that point, I was not working on lakes or water systems. And we were a bunch of people who didn't know really anything about ecology of lakes or even the social uses of lakes in the city and learned as we went along to restore this lake. And now it's one of the most successfully community-rejuvenated lakes in Bangalore. There's also a very iconic road called the Nanda Road in Jayanagar, and that's where one of the first stations of the Bangalore Metro came up, and they had planned to cut down about 500, 600 trees, and there was a very successful long civic protest organized by Hasiru Isiru, which is a civic group in Bangalore organized around trees. Hasiru Isiru means greenery is life, greenery is the breath of life. And I was part of, again, because I grew up in that area, so this was something that was very close to me. So joined the protest. My daughter was born around that time, so she joined the protest with me. We did some, so students who were in there, we started mapping the trees. So what the government estimates were that very few trees would be cut and many of these would be mature and, really not trees that would survive. When my students went and did the estimates, they found that there were about three times as many trees tied with yellow ribbons as they had said they would cut. So, you know, and because of the civic protests in this area led by Hasiru Isiru, the metro landed up chopping, I think, many fewer trees than they planned to take over initially. And so this road, while not as green as it used to be, is still very green. But this is where my motivation to start this research came in. It was not as research, but more as personal engagements with places that I was very passionate about. At that point, I started thinking about my forest research. And though I still continue with that, I think there is something to be said of sense of place and working where you live. And when you're working in some place that is distant and you're going in and out, I always collaborate with local groups, NGOs that are working in the region, but it's still different when I am not in that region. And therefore, your research doesn't have the policy impact that you think it should have or you wish it could have. Whereas if you're from a place, my research in Bangalore was always very much that way linked. And that's why I'm saying it's the social and the ecological were very intimately linked. Whereas my research in forests has been much more ecological. And the personal and the professional have been very much linked. Because it's not just as a researcher, it's looking at the city, thinking of how children like my daughter will grow up in the city, working with other schools, working with other colleges, trying to do ecology as a resident of the city. Where if you write about it tomorrow, you might find the postman talking to you or your aunt talking to you or a neighbor coming down the road and saying, but you wrote this, but I think something completely different about the city. You know, you land up thinking of the place where you live in if you're researching it in a very different way. I'll give you some examples. So this is a set of questions on the left side, which you can think of as sort of the ecology questions or the environmental questions or the natural science questions that drive my study. For instance, why are street trees important in reducing air pollution and temperature? Or what determines whether you plant native trees or exotic trees? Or what factors are important which decide whether community restoration will be successful or not? Any community that gets together to restore a place, whether it will work or not. But these are other, I think, equally important questions on the right, which came through just because of being a resident of the city. So if you look at street vendors, there are groups of street bamboo street vendors, for instance, on a road called Kia Road, again, which was affected by tree felling for the metro. And they were very iconic in Bangalore, and many people know them as a signature of the road. How have they been affected by tree felling and resettlement? Now, this is not a research question. But this is a question that's very important for the survival of the city, because if a city's growth paradigm thinks of roads and metros as much more important than street vendors, then there is something wrong with the fundamental way in which that city is trying to organize itself. Or another one, there was a very successful movement in the 1990s, part of Cubbon Park, which was going to be taken over to create a legislator's home, including some, you know, fairly like a clubhouse for legislators. And a very middle-class movement, they called themselves, this organization called Sanmati, Mothers and Others. They just stood there, 7-8 of them on the roadside, days before the internet, before social media, they didn't have much money. And that organization slowly grew momentum till within a by the time there was a month, there were thousands of school kids, policemen's wives used to join the protest while the policemen were standing and guarding the protest. You know, it became one of the most successful protests in and campaigns in Bangalore, and they stopped this legislator's home, the plans for this legislator's home. So when you start studying a city to tell people or to communicate with people about its restoration, you find stories are as important. Research studies are important. Of course, people want to know how much pollution can one street tree reduce, you know? Those kinds of facts and numbers are important. But they want to know stories of people and places. They want to know histories. And so this entire project became a mix of research and storytelling. I'll give you examples of these. And these are some of the things we have done. So there are articles in newspapers, which can be Kannada newspapers, can be Hindi newspapers. These are, again, some of them are based on research, some of them are not. There are things like lake walks that we've been doing. So, you know your local neighborhood lake. Or for instance, the Sampangi, the Kantirwa Stadium, which used to be a lake. Walk around your lake and get to know it. So this is the way in which we've been trying to work on this city as a mixture of stories and research. And with that mix comes the book, Nature in the City. So it's really a set of, trying to integrate information on nature, which you see to the left, and of people and places. And when I say people and places, it has to be all kinds of people and places. People in the past, as you can see in that old photograph, which is the Avenue Road areas in the 1890s. Street vendors, it could be slum children, it could be children from a local village which has been swallowed by urban development trying to save a lake. So it's all kinds of people and all kinds of places. Now with that background, let me now start telling you the story of Bangalore, which comes through in the city. Most of you, I'm sure if you've even been in Bangalore for a short while, would have known the, at least the Wikipedia history of Bangalore, which is what? Which is, in 1537 comes Kempegowda, there's this chieftain, and there is this barren land which he's walking through. He sees, there are various stories, but the most popular one is he sees a hare chasing a hound. And he says this is a sign of bravery, of what they call a Gandabhumi, a place for warriors. And because of this, he decides to create a city here. And he has these four bullocks and he plows them to four directions, and where they stop is the, you know, the gateposts of the city, and that's where he creates Bangalore. That, to large extent, we don't know. It could be fact, it could be a myth. I mean, the real details of the story, there's nothing written down and there's nothing recorded from those areas. What we do have in terms of the oldest written description of Bangalore comes from the 1640s. So all of you have heard of Shivaji? Is there anyone who's not? Nobody who's not heard of Shivaji, right? How many of you know that Shivaji was married in Bangalore? The only Marathi person, I guess. Yeah. So Shaji, Shivaji's father, was working with the Bijapur Sultanate. In 1638, the Bijapur Sultanate marched on with Shaji at its head and took over Bangalore from Kempegowda's descendants. Okay, and the last person who was here was also called Kempegowda, moved to Magadi and became termed Magadi Kempegowda, and he took over that place. And Shaji then got gifted Bangalore as a jagir in return for his work in this entire campaign. Yeah, and Shivaji was actually born here. And then the Bangalore was gifted to Shaji's younger son, Venkoji, for a while. Now, Shaji had a court poet called Parmanand. And Parmanand in 1670s wrote about this description of entire Shaji's entire life. And he described Bangalore in the late 1630s. And this is some excerpts from there. Okay, he says Bingrul, which is what they called it. He said, this is the matchless city with smart fortifications and towers. It resounded with contented coos of countless pigeons safe in their nests. It was animated by the calls of peafowl dashing in and out of skylights. Now we have the pigeons, we don't have the peafowl, but we do have peafowl in all the forest areas around Bangalore. And earlier on, even about 20, 30 years ago, we used to have peafowl in the city. So this is, you know, something that has not changed. The city teemed with deep lakes. Each house was graced by a well. And again, if you look at Bangalore, even 30 years ago, most houses had wells. Trees, fountains gurgled at every square, spouting a fine mist. And this is also something that people who lived in the city in the 50s and 60s will tell you, that there used to be fountains around the area. Trees thick with flowers and shade lined each home garden. The city was girdled by a bottomless moat glimmering with water and dotted with countless lakes, each as big as a sea. Picturesque parks, festooned with creepers swinging gaily in the breeze, all adorned the city. And Shaji ruled here. Of course, it's a court poet, so he thought, you know, this is what he has to say. Shaji ruled here like Indra in his paradise, enjoying every sport and pastime with his kinfolk. But look at the description of the city, and this is what we call the garden city of Bangalore, or the Kalyananagara, the lake city of India, right? Because it is a city with greenery, with lakes, with trees, and it had the same visual image of it that we still have today. But unfortunately, in recent years, it's been derisively called the garbage city of India because we have the solid waste crisis, right? We have this health crisis because of mosquitoes and all this garbage around. Now, how and where has the city changed? This is the story of the growth of Bangalore. Now, if you look at the map, that small red dot in the center was Kempegowda's original city. It stayed like this for a very long time till Chikaraja Wodeyar came along and added from the Pete area, he added what is the Kote area. So that is from the city, which is the Avenue Road, Chikpet, all those areas. He added the fort, what was the Bangalore fort. And then from there, you'll see every successive ruler, the city expanded. The big jump happened when the British created their cantonment in India, in Bangalore. And then from there on, it's steadily grown. And you can see each successive growth phase, the city is almost doubled. Right? And even now, if you look at the physical boundary of the city, what would be the urban extent of the city? That will be far beyond BBMP limits because the city spreads out far beyond the administrative limits. Now, as I said, this city we think of as having been started by Kempegowda when nothing was there. But if you look at the older ecological history, you can see that there was a lot going on in this landscape before Kempegowda. And this gives us a sense of how geography, how ecology shapes what you could do in the city. Now, what do we get as evidences for this? There are these stones, inscriptional material found on copper plates and found on stones. And there are various good sources. So there's Epigraphia Karnataka, which has all the epigraphs written down. There are various other archaeological survey of India, Karnataka survey, which have all these epigraphs written down. There are various kinds. Some of them are land grants written on stones. Some of them are what are they called Veerakallus in Kannada, which is hero stones, which talk about the death of a brave warrior. There are various other kinds of records of, you know, fights and resolutions and things like that. But importantly, what you can do with these is you can use them to find out when a village was first talked about, right? So what existed in this landscape before Kempegowda? Now, Bangalore is an ancient settlement, so you can see even up to 3,000, 4,000 years ago, there are dolmens and various kinds of, you know, archaeological remains that tell you that there were ancient people living in this area, and there were burial stones. But we don't know anything about them, what they, you know, how they ate, what they did, and where they lived, and did they even live here, were these just burial sites? We don't really know anything. But from the 6th century AD onwards, from about 540, you start seeing these inscriptions of which you can start to record. And they fall into four major dynasties: the Gangas, the Cholas, the Hoysalas, and then the Vijayanagara Empire. So if you look at the Gangas, this is what you call a topographic map of Bangalore. So this tells you the undulations, how it goes up and down. And can you see, you should be able to see fairly clearly that there is a, there are two regions. If you look at the western side, it's much more undulating, right? And the eastern side is far flatter. And Bangalore, if you look at it historically, when the British came in, one of the first things they recorded that people told them was that Bangalore is divided into what they call the Malnad and the Maidan. The Malnad or the Malenadu is the area to the west which has rolling hills. Those of you again who from Bangalore will know these big granite rocky outcrops, you know, these big boulders that are there. So that is the Malenadu. You have a lot of up and downs, a lot of hilly areas. It was in the rain shadow of the western ghat, so it didn't get as much rain as the east side. The soil is much thinner. It gets much more, so the vegetation is very different. You get this thorny kind of scrub, which is not suitable for agriculture. It's much more suitable for pastoralism, and there are a lot of wildlife in this, in that part of the region, the western area. You can see the ridges. So there are two long ridges that cut through. And somewhere here, for instance, those of you who know Bangalore, is the High Grounds. High Grounds Police Station, which is next to the golf course. It's called High Grounds because it's the highest point in Bangalore, right? So that's the Malnad. The Maidan, which is also called the Bailu in Kannada, which is the area to the east, is flatter. It gets more rainfall. Soil is more fertile, capable of agriculture. So you can have paddy, you can have ragi. And so the kind of cultivation, the kind of land use, the kind of livelihoods you had in this region is very different. Now, when you see the earlier settlements in the Ganga dynasty, where did they come in? You know, if, think of it, if you were coming in an early landscape, you would obviously come and settle in the Maidan areas, because it's easier to clear, easier to grow. And Bangalore, water. So what is interesting is Bangalore is an old civilization which is very unique in a way of being in a semi-arid region, distant from a major water source. There's no river, there's no coast. Where did they get their water from? From what we call lakes today, but these lakes are tanks, they're all man-made. So that is when there were depressions in the ground, people came, cleared out the depressions, and used that for rainwater harvesting. And again, where would you do that? It's much easier to do that in the Maidan area because it's flatter and you can collect more rain. So you can see that all of the earlier settlements, Ganga dynasty settlements, are all in the Maidan area. Then you come to the Cholas. Now there's not that much going on in the Chola time in Bangalore area. Of course, there is in other parts of South India. But you can see that they slowly start moving into the hilly parts of the city because they're running out of space. There's a burst of activity between the 13th and 14th centuries during the Hoysala period. And the Hoysalas were big tank builders. Now they start expanding into the rest of the city. And you can see the Sandras. Look at Honga Sandra, for instance. Sandra is Samudra. Samudra is large body of water. And that means lake, basically. So the Hoysalas were big tank builders, and you can see many of these. And there are many others. So there's Tavara Kere. Kere is, which is the fifth one. That Kere is also a body of water. Then if you look at, 19 and 20, Mallasandra, Singasandra, they're also tanks. Suli Kunte in 21, Kunte is a small body of water. And these were built by large varieties of people, you know, not just always the rich people. So Suli Kunte means a prostitute's tank, and this was a local prostitute, at least that's what the story says, who used her earnings to build a tank for the village's community service. So they were built by a variety of people, not just the chieftains of the region, right? But supported always. Dodna Nekkundi in 23, the Kundi is also a small body of water. So there were all of these lake building going on in this region, and the Hoysala spread across it. Then the 14th to 16th centuries in the Vijayanagara dynasty. And I stop at 1537 when Kempe Gowda comes in. I have not charted these beyond. But by the time Kempe Gowda came in, there were already 75 villages around. So this idea that he came in into this barren land where he constructed this market city de novo is really not true. In fact, when he came in, Achyuta Devaraya, who was the Vijayanagara king at that point, gave him a jagir of 11 villages around Bangalore. And the reason he could do that was because there were these villages around Bangalore, right? So it was a market town, it was a network of, there was already a commercial thriving activity going on in this place where Kempe Gowda came in. Now, what else do you know about this? So this tells you that by this time that Kempe Gowda came in, the entire landscape was settled. People started coming from the Maidan. But there were still very different activities going on in these two places. And the inscriptions look very different from the Maidan and from the Malnad. If you go to the Maidan, this is a typical inscription from a place called Kempapura, which is now near this Belandur Lake. Look at the way they describe the place. There is the lake, there is the tank, the Avanji Kattu of the village, and then they describe the landscape as being composed of the wet and the dry lands, which is the irrigated and the non-irrigated, and the wells underground and the trees overground. And they are thinking of this integrated landscape which we have completely forgotten now. We are only thinking of the land. They think of the trees above ground, the wells and the water which you get below the ground, because this is a groundwater dependent area, and the irrigated land and the wet and the dry land. So their conception is very much of that of an agricultural area supported by wells, right? In the hills, in the Malnad, you get completely different kind of inscriptions, and they're typically hero stones of warriors who were killed during hunts or groups that fight each other during cattle raids. So the person who's killed by a wild boar, a person who's killed by a tiger, another person who's killed by a tiger, cattle raids. Many of these come from areas called Kanakanhalli, which is now what we call Kanakpura, which is close to the Banerghatta National Park, which is still areas of high wildlife. This is where the leopards come into the city from, the elephants come into the city from, and which is where our national park is. So very different parts of the city, right? Now what do we have today? This is your boundary of BBMP. And these are the lake, this is the lake networks in the region. They're in three topographic zones. There are three valley systems in Bangalore. Yeah? We don't even know about this. The Malnad and the Maidan, the fact that rainfall is different, the soil is different, the topography is different, the drainage patterns are different, is not something that builders take into account, planners take into account. When you have a rocky granite outcrop, you blast it and you can raise it to the ground. I have seen, you know, in my 30, 40 years in Bangalore, so many areas that used to be rocky and there were no buildings there have now been all raised and there are apartment complexes up, right? And there are so many places that were marshy again that were left alone as wetlands that have been filled with soil and people have constructed apartments. So we think of ecology, topography, geography, rainfall, all of these climatic factors as being irrelevant. You can build anywhere and the city is a flat equalizer place. But that's not true. Because in times of environmental stress, it comes back and hits us. So for instance, a few good floods and the rains, you know, last week is a very good example of that. Few good rains and the city floods because they say low-lying areas are getting affected. What are low-lying areas? Areas that are wetlands and lakes that should not have been built on, right? On the other hand, it's a very peculiar thing. So Bangalore, Chennai, if you think of it, during the summer, the city runs dry. During the rainy season, the city floods, and that makes no sense. Because if you have so much water that the city is flooding, you should not have a problem, you know, 3-4 months later when there's no rainfall and the city has drought and you don't have any water and you have a water crisis. So this just means we have completely forgotten the ecology of the city and we tend to think of this as a very neutral sphere. So this is what, for instance, geographers call first nature versus second nature and third nature. So first nature is where nature really controls people and what people can do and shapes things. And by the time you come to third nature, the third nature is a kind of nature where people have brought the nature and people have mentally reconstructed the landscape and, you know, more or less flattened the whole area and treated it as an equal kind of a flat plane, which is completely homogeneous and completely similar. But that doesn't work because nature is nature at the end and really has the last laugh. So that's the first point I want to make about Bangalore. And there are three points that I'll make through this book. So this is the first one, that we've forgotten about the history and the way in which the geography influences the city, but it's really important. Now, what about the second? So moving from this pre-Kempe Gowda period to Kempe Gowda and post that, we really don't have, as I said, much knowledge of what happened during Kempe Gowda's time, apart from some oral information which is recorded as myths and anecdotes. And really a lot of different stories are there. Then we know that after that there was a lot of turmoil after the Kempe Gowda dynasty was removed for a long while. And then there was a period of relative stability during the period from about 1720 to 1799 between Hyder and Tipu. So Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan ruled this entire region, and because there were two of them, they were constantly fighting off, of course, numerous other contenders for this position, including the Mysore kings, the Marathas, the British, you know, the Portuguese for a while, trying to make French allies. So there was a lot going on in the region. But still the period, there was a relative time of stability. Then in 1799, Tipu fell. So 1791 for a while, in the third Anglo-Mysore war, Bangalore was lost for a while to the British. Then Tipu ransomed himself back sometime towards the end of 1792. But the important fact here for us when you're looking at regarding the history of the city is the British come in 1791. And the first thing the British do is they make sketches, they make maps, they document things, because that's what they do. Right? Inveterate documenters of everything. So in 1791, we get this map of the city. And I have put in the Pete and the fort towards the left. I've also sketched in what I call the cantonment. Of course, in 1791, there was no cantonment. But I'm just telling you the area where it used to be. What can you see here? I'll show you maps now in a series from 1791 to 1888 to 2015. And I want you to see an interesting thing. If you're looking at two aspects of the nature in this city, lakes and trees. And it's a semi-arid region, right? In a semi-arid region, you have fewer trees because it's going to be a largely open area. And you have lakes which are created. So I want you to see how over time lakes increase and then decrease, and trees sort of more or less uniformly increase. And we'll get to why. So this is 1791, and you can see this entire collection of lakes. By 1888, the British are here, the cantonment is thriving. There are a lot more lakes which they add, because you need a lot, there's more water that you need for people. And in fact, there are studies from that time that start saying that lakes in the city are much larger than lakes in rural areas, because they have to be, because there are more people in the city, these large reservoirs. This is also a lake. You can see it was created, and then there were two sides of it, right, at that time. So Alsur Lake, in fact, if you go before, this is very small. It's not only enlarged, it's also, you know, they make these two sections, one of which is now gone. Right? Trees start being planted. And if you look at the archival material around 1840s, you see this discussion that starts talking about urbanization and heat. And they say, oh, the city has become very hot. We have too many people. We used to have these thick fireplaces. We don't need them in the anymore. Sepoys couldn't fire their muskets in the morning because their hands would be benumbed with the cold. And they don't have this problem now. The city has become too hot to live in. We need to start planting trees. This is 1840s. So in 1860s, they start this aggressive plan of planting trees. And the British who started planting trees followed the Indian, classical Indian idea of a garden, which Kalidasa propounded called Ritu Samhara, which means in every season you must have flowering trees. And of course, the British have a palette which is global, right? They can bring trees from any part of the world to flower. So they start bringing trees from Madagascar, from Latin America, from Brazil, you know, from everywhere across the world. And all these majestic trees that you see, the rain tree, the copper pod, the gulmohar, all of these are brought in from outside. Some of them can shade an entire quarter acre at a time. And they plant this entire city. So you can see lakes and trees in 1888. Now in 1888 to 1892, there's a period of successive drought. Actually from the 1870s onwards, there are cyclical droughts. In 1888, the city really completely runs out of water, and there's a big scarcity crisis. Right? They start deepening Dharmam Buddhi tank, which is now majestic. They run out of water. They start deepening a few other tanks. They create Sankey's tank. They create the Miller's tank series. There's not enough water. Then they start saying, this city cannot provide, you know, it can't look for water internally. We have to import water from outside. And they create this Hesagatta project, where they start getting water from outside the city. And for the first time, piped water comes into the city around 1892. Suddenly, you see in the archives, the entire discourse around water completely changes. water is before, obviously, in Indian civilizations, water is sacred, it's life-giving, it's something that you worship across all religions, right? And suddenly now water becomes a source of pollution. They say, oh, these lakes are filthy, the wells are polluted, people throw dead bodies into the wells during times of, you know, plague or whatever because they don't want to be discovered. And you disinfect the wells, you disinfect the lakes, you just clear them. They become these open grounds where you can convert them into bus stands and do other kinds of urban development with them. You fill all the wells. So the entire narrative around water in the city completely changes from life-giving and pure to impure and polluted and dirty and to be disposed of. And look at this map, and I'll show you 2015 now. We'll go back, okay, 1888 and 2015. There's Alsur Lake that is left, and it's half its size. Trees have increased, and that's because the city continues to get hotter, right? More trees are planted. Of course, what this map, I don't have a map from the 1990s. What you don't see is here is in the past 15, 20 years, hundreds of thousands of trees have been cut. So what you would see, what you see in 2015, if you saw a map of, let's say, 1995, you would see a lot more trees. Because there was a lot of plantation till then, and in the past 15, 20 years, we have A, not planted, and B, cut down a lot of trees for various kinds of infrastructure projects. But what does this tell us? Less lakes, more trees, right? And why is this? And the argument here is that when your loop is local, the city is resilient because it protects what it uses. And when you don't use it, why are our cities such polluting entities? Because we get everything from outside. We get our food from outside, we get our water from outside, we get our energy from outside, and we send our waste far away, again outside. Now when your loop is not local, when you don't use what you see, and when you don't suffer the consequences of what you do or don't do, why would you have sustainable behavior? So once you start importing water from outside, it's so clear to see this pattern of water, you know. So for instance, we did this survey of wells, and there were these open wells across Bangalore, which you'll see across India also, these large step wells, small wells. So the open step wells, in the early 1930s, there were 1,495 step wells, open wells, large open wells recorded in the maps. Now there are barely 30 functional ones in the city. Sorry, 30 existing ones, they're not functional. Most of them are dumped with garbage, but at least they're there and they can be revived, right? So you think of the amount, there were all these kalyanis, these open reservoirs, which, you know, you'll see temple kalyanis, you know what I mean by those square reservoirs with steps. They were not just temple ones in Bangalore, so they were there across the city. Every lake had about 7-8 of these distributed around, again, which people used to use to draw water from. There's now one left in the city or two left in the city, which are used as recreational spaces, they're no longer bodies of water, apart from the ones in the temples. So we have really lost this tradition of looking at water. Trees, because the city is hot and it's polluted, we do depend on trees. But even with trees, there's a shift in time. So that's my second argument. The second argument is once we lose the local loop in the city as the city grows, you really see the change. And that, you know, water versus trees is a very good contrast. And the third is even that though we have trees, our appreciation of plants or trees have changed because we have simplified this as, so there's an urban aesthetic that comes as the city expands, which from a very organic use of nature, which is very biodiverse, and people, social uses are also very diverse, and the biodiversity is also very rich, it becomes much more simplified. You have a very small pellet of a very few trees and plants, and the social uses become restricted to recreational uses and a few very simplified cultural practices. You know, Ganesha immersion during, idol immersion, you know, a couple of things like that. And I'll show you what I mean. So this is an example of lakes, which were, you know, how were lakes used? In so many ways, right? Of course you use them for recreation and nature watching, but you also use them for cattle washing, dhobis, I mean all, there were dhobi ghats across Bangalore, some of them still survive. Migrant workers used them when they came in. Lakes were used for fishing, for firewood collection, for all kinds of other purposes. There were always little, you know, so there was always a lake which had a Kere Amma, which is a local lake deity next to the lake. You'll see in some places near the Indian telephone industries, if you look near Hosur Road, there is the Kere Amma temple, but there is no Kere anymore. And I've seen that lake actually being closed, right? Now look at the woman collecting greens, and you see the importance of these lakes as shifting areas. In Bangalore, because it was a dry area, there was always times of seasons that there would be rain and season, you know, years where there would be no rain. So when there was rain, you would do fishing, you would do agriculture. When there was no rain, you get this kind of a barren lake bed, and these greens start growing on the lake bed as it dries. And it's called Wanagane Soppu. It's a bitter green which has a lot of medicinal properties and nutritional properties. So women collect them. You will see them also, even now in the hearts of many parts of the Bangalore, sold on carts. Right? So their livelihood support, their nutritional support, we have talked to slums, for instance, around many of the lakes. And as the lakes slowly start getting either polluted or people start getting excluded from them, then women cannot collect the greens and they can't afford to buy greens. What does this mean then? Entire generations are growing up nutritionally deprived, which means their brains get affected, the way they can study. You know, it's a lot of cascading effects that you have as a result of this. Now, what happens with these lakes? They were used in diverse ways. Some of them, of course, get polluted or converted into malls or bus stands or whatever, right? When they do get rejuvenated, often, unfortunately, they get rejuvenated and simplified for nature watching, for recreation, with gates and with timings and with lists of activities. And you go to any of these lakes and you'll see a list of don't pluck, don't fish, don't swim, okay, don't do this, don't do that. You know, what you can do basically is non-consumptive activities. You can go around, walk, do recreation. What kind of trees do you plant? BBMP, for instance, or even local resident associations are very nervous about planting multifunctional, so a lot of food trees that we used to plant. What would we plant typically? Jamun and tamarind and those kinds of trees, right? Across, I mean, this is not Bangalore alone, any Indian cities. Now you want only ornamental trees because it becomes very, the fruits drop, they become messy, you have to pay people a lot to clean it up, people will fight over the food. So all these problems that you anticipate, and you just create flowering plants, right, with nobody can really use or fight over. Similarly, Bangalore had this tradition of gundutops, or village forests across the city. This was a tradition that oral history says was set up by Hyder Ali, and then Tipu Sultan, and then the British continued it after that. And you had these village, so every village had a forest, which largely had jamun, jackfruit, certain kind of mango, which were used for fuel wood, they were used for construction, but they were also used for eating. Now, as the city grows and swallows all of these areas, most of them become degraded or converted into public utilities, like the school that you see here. Right? Few that exist, two or three, again get gated and converted into parks for recreational purposes. And it's very interesting if you talk to the communities, why do they do this? Two reasons. One, they say they want the Gundutop as a park because that's the only way it will stay theirs. Otherwise, the city government comes and takes it over and says, let's do slum resettlement here or let's do some other kind of public utility here. They say the only way we can do it is claim it as a park. The second thing, though, is an interesting thing about how urbanization influences the way in which we think of nature. Because what they say is we have also developed now. We were a village, now we become part of the city. We also want a jogging area, a walking path, we want these benches, we want some, you know, recreational, these certain kinds of trees. And there's an aspirational value associated with having a certain kind of a park. So this is with topes. Again, if you look at, so KR Road, this is what KR Road, so all our streets are like this. These were wooded streets with vibrant street life, and these are ficus trees, banyan trees. And this is a photo from the 1930s. And this is the street that I was talking about, which is high speed now with a very few trees, and the street vendors, the bamboo vendors, have all but disappeared from this area. This has repercussions on the way in which they live their lives also. Because if you talk to the bamboo vendors, when they had the trees, it gave them privacy and shelter, but there were things that they used. So when one of the vendors who is now in his 60s and leading a protest movement of the group, because they're going to get resettled soon, says that when his mother got a cough, all his father would do is go and make a cut in this banyan tree, and there was a sap, you could take out the sap, mix it with the ragi balls of the night before, and she would swallow it first thing in the morning, and he said she never had to go to the doctor because it was an infallible cure for coughs and colds. Now in the city, you don't get banyan trees on the road, and I had never heard of this use, I mean, despite all of our work on biodiversity in the city, I never heard of this. And so our very knowledge of biodiversity is vanishing along with the simplification, right? So it's not just a loss of life of street vendors, but it's a loss of all that we can learn from them also about how to live with these. Parks have also simplified. So this trend is there through all public spaces. So Lal Bagh is a heritage garden. How many of you have not been to Lal Bagh? Well, you should go very soon then. But Lal Bagh was set up by Hyder and Tipu, so it was always a mix of an orchard and a botanical garden. And it still has those elements. So there are a couple of old mango trees, now one left that belonged to Tipu Sultan, at least that's what they say. And so you have some very nicely landscaped areas, but you have areas that are a little more wild. And this is another example of the new parks that have come across the city. Very landscaped, very small. And even the shrubs that you have are these variegated plants with multicolored leaves but very few flowers. The idea being that they look pretty the year round and maintenance costs are low. And it's very ironic because you get, you know, tankers in when the city is already so dry, you're pumping in water with these tankers to water all these lawns. When you look at the older parks in the city and they had trees, you don't really need to water them because the trees are old and they can take care of themselves. Home gardens also. Bangalore is famous for its home gardens and bungalows, and the bungalows need not be large bungalows. Of course, there are some, but this is a small, beautiful little bungalow from the Baswangudi area. You can see, just got enough place for a little scooter, and even the creepers that are on there are all creepers with beans and lentils that you can eat. It's a mix, and when you do our studies, we've seen only 30% of the plants that people plant in their home gardens are purely ornamental. 70% are used for something or the other, cooking, worship, medicinal use, you know, some kind of use. This has an important spillover effect for biodiversity, because if you're eating what you produce, you don't plant it with pesticides. Your children play there, your pets play there, you don't, you know. So you keep it more organic in a very natural way because you're using this. And therefore, we find that there are a lot more insects here, for instance, than apartment complexes, which are largely manicured. Very few fruiting plants or food plants, because they come up with the same things that people are going to fight over them, about who uses the produce, right? And you spray it a lot because nobody uses it. And therefore you have very few, if you look at the birds and the insects and the other biodiversity that lives here, very little. It might look green, but there's a everything that looks green is not the same. There's a simplification. So that's my third argument, that nature as a city grows leads to the simplification of cultural uses of nature and social uses, as well as the simplification of biodiversity. Now with that said, where is the hope then, right? You find hope in two places, and they were kind of surprising places for us. One is slums. So I had a master's student who was doing her thesis, and she wanted to look at slums, and that's how this whole idea started. And she said, why is it that nobody looks at slums and biodiversity? And why should we just assume that slums don't have biodiversity? So we started this program where she was looking. And what we found was slums were one of the last refuges for multifunctional nature. So there are some of these older slums. There are two kinds of slums broadly in Bangalore. And some of these are these new peri-urban slums which are largely tented and people live in this very temporary. Every 2-3 months they change their migrant labor, construction labor. I'm talking about the older slums of Bangalore which people have been there for 50, 60 years and you know they're smaller houses. They plant trees, they plant small kinds of plants in old buckets, paint cans, utensils, plastic sacks, anything that they can find. And they water them and they look after them with great care. So they have a very high proportion of local, native species is highest. 65% native species, 70% useful species. The highest that we've seen in any land use category. And again, it's partly for consumption, which is very important for nutritional support, but also for mental well-being. So we are asking this lady in Bhatrahalli, this one of these slums here, which has, it's next to a very polluted lake, water comes from a long distance, and she has this lovely little patch of garden with aloe vera and various other things. So we said, what do you use aloe vera for? She said, my daughter had planted it, and she's now married, and I now sort of maintain it thinking of her, and she said, I'll tell you in Kannada first and then I'll translate. She said, Nimmanta aur parlor ig hogtara, nammanta aur idu upyogistive, which means basically, people like you go to the parlor, people like us, this is our parlor, right? And then you think of an entire way of life around this garden, you know, you're living in a slum and you have very little, but that doesn't mean that you don't want to, you know, look good or have spent some time investing in yourself and feeling a sense of satisfaction. So there are multiple things to this. There's a local knowledge that they have about the uses. And there's a lot of sense of pride in having something that is unique. So they will tell you that they went to somebody's house very far away because, so everyone wants rare species in their garden. Now the same pride you see in homeowners, you see in these residents who are they have such little, but they have such beautiful gardens. The second place is very interesting, sacred places. We looked at the symmetries, all kinds of symmetries, the Islamic symmetries, the Christian symmetries, the Hindu symmetries in Bangalore, Hosur Road has all three next to each other. Beautiful, large heritage trees. You know, if you look at the mosques, the churches, the temples, across Bangalore, these are areas where there's going to be very little land use change, where there are resilient practices, because all religions basically have this idea that nature is sacred and has to be worshipped, right? So people leave out food, rice for the birds, or have other practices of worship. And so, for instance, this is a an example of a temple from Malleshwaram. And this temple is where there's a spring from the Arkavati. Okay, so it's called Nandi Tirtha. And there was a natural spring that was covered up. The area was going to become an apartment complex, and the residents had forgotten about this temple. And then somebody remembered during this, and then they created a protest and sort of revived this temple and dug it out. And you can see this pigeon drinking from the spring water. And really, there's so much biodiversity and, you know, local traditions that are resilient here. Ashwat kattes, these platforms that you will see across the city with ficus tree and another neem tree next to it. You'll see that when one tree dies, another one is planted. And it's not planted by the government, it's not planted by temple authorities, it's not planted by any formal authorities. Again, I have a PhD student working on this. And what she finds is it's an informal community group. But they're maintaining and monitoring this. And as soon as one tree dies, another one is planted. And so there's this tradition. And if you look at areas like Baswangudi, where she's looked at, or Malleshwaram, there are places which are completely barren or almost devoid of trees, except for these kattes. And when you map the distribution of these kattes and these large trees that they find, you find canopies give you the stepping stones. So birds and butterflies and other, you know, wildlife can move from tree to tree, really, as stepping stones in the city. And this gives them a very important connectivity. So what do you find with this? There are three trajectories of ecosystem change, right? One is degradation and disappearance, which is, for instance, like the lakes and the wells. The local use of cycle of use is broken. And from something that was valued, it becomes a wasteland or a polluted resource. And the second is protection and simplification, as we saw with many of the parks or many of the lakes, that it is restored for recreation, but it's restored for a recreation in a very simplified way, simplified from the perspective of biodiversity and simplified from the perspective of human use. And the third is really what we want in the city, right? Maintenance is a multifunctional resource, which pays for provisioning, that is for use for food or for fish or for fuel wood or for various uses, as well as for cultural services to support old and new users, because the city is a mix of migrants who come in with their new expectations as well as people who had lived here for a long time. And that is where what we find what with slums and sacred spaces, which are very organic commons. And really that's the question. In our cities of the future, how do we support commons, these nature as commons? Now, so what you can say? If you're looking at Bangalore, what does this tell us, the slums and sacred places and areas of the commons? Is this just a story about one city? Here's now, I'll move you from, I hope you can see this clearly, from the nightlights image of the world, I want you to move you to a nightlights image of India. And you can see that there are very few areas that are not covered by lights. There's the northeast, there's parts of central India, and there's parts of the Kutch area. Everything else, more or less, the city, the country has been overtaken by lights. This itself is a 2009 night lights image, and we don't have a recent one, but the recent one, I'm sure, will be far, with a far higher coverage of lights. So in its specifics, what I'm saying is this is a story of Bangalore, but in its more broader things, and as I've been talking to people across the country, across not just India, but actually outside, you know, cities across the world, there are parallels to cities across the world, and definitely to cities in India, which have this aspiration for growth, massive, fast growth, but they also have this deep connection to nature. So how then does this deep connection to nature, which is very organic, deal with this fast pace of growth, right? So nature in Bangalore has witnessed centuries of change. It's been brown and dusty at one point. It moved to blue and green, and now it's become gray, right? Concrete everywhere. What has happened over this time is our organic connection with nature is disrupted. And it's led to a lot of degradation and decay. But nature is thriving in places like slums and lakes and sacred spaces that are managed by communities and used as commons. And this could be our pathway forward for the future. But if this is our pathway forward for the future, where is it in planning and policy then? And look at what we see in urbanization in India. So what are our visions for the future? We're 32% urban, we're supposed to become 50% urban in the next 15, 20 years. And our visions are largely these smart cities. It was 100 cities, now it's 109. That number keeps fluctuating. There's very little on the smart, on environment in these cities. Huh? There are odd kinds of, so first of all, the smart cities is focused largely on technology. There was this notification on the MOUD website, which they later took off, thankfully, which said smart cities are for smart people. So you can, there's a lot of subtext in that statement. Smart people, I presume, are the ones with smartphones. So, you know, it goes to a lot of those kinds of things. what is a smart environment? They just talk about planting trees. Let's plant a lot of trees. Now, what you can you just plant, for instance, eucalyptus or acacia? So, you know, if you look at industries in India, the Indian Tobacco Company, ITC. ITC says it's the only or one of the few carbon neutral companies in India, because it plants for everything that it harvests and all the damage that it does to the environment, it plants. What does it plant? It plants eucalyptus plantations across. And so there are trees and there are trees. I mean, just planting, which is mentioned in these MOUD documents, is what do you plant, who uses the plants? There is, if you look at the entire discussion of, let's take Bangalore, our Bangalore Development Authority, BDA plans, or the rural BMRDA plans, or any city development plans, there is no discussion of the commons. There is no discussion of urban foraging, the use of nature, public nature, to actually collect things from. There is no mention of that. Where it is mentioned, it's largely mentioned as illegal. And it's not in any plans and policies, but in these, you know, you go to a park or you go to a lake and you have this list of do's and don'ts. Don't do this, don't do that, don't pluck this, don't pluck that. It's in our older cities where this tradition survives. I had gone to Karanji Lake in Mysore last year, and it was very nice. It made me think of how Bangalore was before. There's somebody jogging across the lake. There's a tiny fence this much between this and the lake. So kids and dogs can't get in, but an adult can step over. So he stops jogging on the way. There's a neem tree. He just went, leaned over, plucked off a branch, put it in his pocket, and continued jogging. Probably going to take it home and use it for something. And this is something I realized I would have seen so much in Bangalore, you know, even 20 years ago. It was very common that we had a neem tree at home. Anybody who walked in would reach across the gate and pluck a bit of our tree and, you know, take it away. And my mother used to get angry and try and put these barbed wires. There would be migrant workers who would come in and, you know, if it takes some of the food. If you didn't lock your gates in the afternoon, there would be a cow. We had a cow who used to come with its horn and pull up the gate latch and come in and start eating the roses. It was a very different city 20, 30 years ago, and it has become a very different city now. So what this makes me wonder is Mysore going to become Bangalore inevitably? And are all the cities that we have, these small towns which are much more organic, are they all going to go this way, which becomes more gated, more simplified, and only certain kinds of uses of nature permitted? Certainly, if you look at all the city urban planning documents, they seem to reflect this version of the city. That all you need trees for are for reducing pollution, all you need lakes for cleaning up the water, and for recharging groundwater. That's all they're going to be used for. Clean air, clean water. And there's so much more that we learn. You know, the whole idea of thinking about nature, an aesthetic, an appreciation for living with multiple kinds of beings, right? And the other thing we don't realize, so coming, you know, if I talk to about the lake that I first spoke about as an urban commons, you know, Kaikandrali Lake, which we restored. So many other urban movements have spawned because of people meeting around the lake, people who didn't know each other. They were living in distant apartments. Everybody works, and in a city, you're busy. But because of this, there have been health groups that started for urban exercise. There have been road work groups. There have been groups that are working on solid waste management, groups that are working on education, groups that are working on so many things because they met around the lake. And now that I'm reading literature from cities across the world, there are, you know, Bogota, for instance, there was a park that was recreated. And because of that park, when it was restored, there were a number of grandmothers that came and started sitting there, and there was drug dealing in that area, and they discovered it and, you know, got the entire drug, thing cleaned up. And the park is now a place which is a rejuvenated place for youth to play. And this tells you the power of an urban green commons to give you a sense of place, a sense of neighborhood. Because the problem with our cities is they're growing so fast. Many of us come into cities and we've been here for a year, 2 years. How do we get a sense of place? When do we become part of the city? When do we start doing something for the city? It seems to be hand-waving broadly that, you know, you stay in a place for about 5 years and then you feel, oh, this is my city, I need to start doing something. But having a place that you do something daily, a mall or a gym is not the same as a lake or a park which you walk in. Definitely not. And there's something to be said about that kind of a place that you visit daily that makes you want to do something for the city. And that's also why you need to have urban commons. So in conclusion, I'll just wind up by saying that this is the story of one city, but I think it's really a story of all cities. And what this tells us is that ecologists are now beginning to look at cities as an legitimate area of study, which means we need different ecological tools, not just our standard tools of looking at biodiversity and maps, but much more social. But the converse has not happened. Himanshu said when he started that this is part of a genre of story, and there have been some very nice, for instance, the book on Ahmedabad. But I think we need urban scholars across the world to also recognize that nature is an integral part of cities. Because most of these other books on cities don't talk about nature. Or if they do, it's sort of in a footnote, so to speak. So we need ecologically smart cities, functional cities, which have to be designed as commons for communities to use, and planned and managed in that way. And there is really nothing in the urban planning discussions anywhere, not just in India, but I think around the world, that talk about this. So there needs to be some kind of movement to really think about, I mean, there's so much discussion of the importance of rural commons, but we don't think of urban commons at all. So with that, I'll conclude. And this is the book, and I think we do have some time for questions. So.
My question is about the now urbanization means more buildings, and I'm thinking of the heat absorption that concrete results in. And my question to you is, did you look at eco architecture or earth buildings, as they say, how can they be integrated in the planning of the city or in the cities that are coming up now? Because it seems that because of the amount of heat that gets trapped in the concrete used, that is leading to more usage of ACs and as such, and we know what they do to the environment and to us also. So were you looking at that earth architecture?
So not specifically in this book, but I'll tell you a couple of things that we have done. So one is a study that we did on roads with street trees. And it's interesting, just by planting trees on the road, you can reduce the air temperature by 3 to 5 degrees, which we sort of know. But the tar temperature reduces by 25 degrees. So it could be a road tar surface of 65 degrees, and it could become a much more bearable 35 degrees, just by planting trees. Now this has spillover effects, not just the AC, but your tendency to use public transport, right? If you have a road that is 65 degrees, it's like walking on a frying pan. You won't walk, you won't cycle, you won't really use the bus and wait for the bus stop. If you can afford it, you'll have an air-conditioned car, right? So this has a lot of spillover effects, just the kind of planting of trees. And then the other thing that we have not worked on directly though is that there are a lot of models that show from the West that planting trees on certain sides of the buildings can reduce your air conditioning cost by 20 to 30%. The models have not been done for India. The cost reduction will be far higher because those are in temperate environments, ours are in tropical environments. We will have much more of a power saving. What this also tells you though is that our idea of LEED certification, you know, these platinum buildings and all that which has come, has to be redone for the Indian environment. If you look at all these LEED certified buildings, they're heavily glass intensive. You'll see all these corporate, so the heat because of the glass, but also the water. Again, this is very ironic that in Bangalore, we're so water scarce, and you'll see in the summer in the drought, you know, all these buildings on the fronts of these large ring roads, basically all the corporate buildings, where you'll find one window cleaner washing it with water. And you have to think what a waste of water. So we are not thinking about this we definitely need much more locally suited urban architecture, which has to come from India. But this is not a focus of my work, that's all.
When we talk about slums and sacred places being the places where nature thrives, aren't these also the places where a lot of waste is produced, and these are the places where a lot of pollution takes place? Like for example, when you have a water body near temples, people generally throw a lot of waste inside the water, like all the flowers and stuff. And and also slums. So isn't this very ironic that these are the places where nature thrives and these are also the places where nature is destroyed?
That's an interesting question. I think that's sort of the typical, normally we tend to think of these places as such, right? As slums are the ones that pollute the lake. Now if you start digging a little deeper, you'll find that many of the slums will tell you that they were originally villages around the lake, and they were the part of the set of people who used to keep it clean and use it. And what happened was, big apartments started being constructed, and when the construction labor came in from some distant place, that's when the pollution happened, and this entire cycle is so exacerbated now that they don't have any other place. They don't have toilets, they don't have a garbage area, and therefore until very recently, and even now, doing a lot of, wherever they can, steps at environmental protection. So I think actually that is a very, you know, that our perception of this is very different often from the reality. And it's the large apartment complexes that land up dumping a lot of sewage at night and dumping trash. Sacred places, it's interesting. And this is something I can't really put in the book, but because it's, or in a paper, but you know, if you look at it, for instance, it's a modern ways of worship, right? Before, you would throw a coconut and a flower into the tank and then it would degrade on its own. But now you throw that coconut and flower in a plastic packet. And so it's that really that is the problem. It's the Ganesha idol would be a mud idol that you threw, but then if you have POP and you want to throw that, then there's a problem. So it's more the way in which we worship. And definitely there is a religious, some religions are far cleaner than others. And unfortunately, many of the temple areas, you will find a lot of pollution.
Hello. Hi. Thank you for the great talk. Looking at the two insights from the temples and the slums, what I understood is, and I might be wrong, these are probably places in a city which are untouched from this reductionist way of Western education, if I can call it that. And so they still preserve a way of life that is very old. It comes naturally to this land. They are still preserving that old way of life. And the modern people, so to say, educated people, are not in touch with that indigenous knowledge. So is that a challenge that you could come across in your research? Do you see that as a challenge? Can we do something to kind of mitigate that?
This is a challenge, and this is something I've been grappling with. One of the things we are doing now at the university is a new project on the commons in Bangalore, trying to look at old commons versus new commons. And when you forge a new commons in the city, which is often by middle class, you know, or upper middle class, more wealthy, you'll have less connect to nature, is it inevitable that it has to be recreation and exclusive? Because some of them are very aware of this and trying to do. So there are, for instance, there's a Jakur lake where they're trying to do something much more inclusive, and they still have, you know, one place where cattle herders can come in, or women from the village can grow medicinal plants and create a cooperative, and you know, fishers can still use it. So how do those kinds of commons come about, and what are the conditions under which they can flourish? That is some. So it's not inevitable, but it is, seems like a trend that is largely to it. The other interesting thing with that is, you know, coming back to link your question to the previous one on these slums, as I was saying, there are two kinds of slums. And it's when you talk about the migrant workers that come in for the apartment complexes, that's inevitably the beginning of this degradation, because they're there for 2-3 months. But if you talk to all these people, they come from rural areas. They have a very strong sense of place in their areas. They have protection, they have a nature ethic. So what happens to this ethic when you move? Is it the desperation of your circumstance? Is it the fact that you move every 3 months, and therefore you don't have chance to develop roots here, and your roots are in one place which you will conserve, but this is some place you're... So that is something I think we don't have an understanding of. We really need to get a better understanding of this.
Hello. Thank you very much. It was very nice talk. Actually, when I saw the concluding slide, I thought, no, it should not be a concluding slide. Still more I want to hear. So that was the feeling. And maybe, you know, more than the question, I would like to compliment for all the different things. Maybe my idea was idea about these trees, and when I saw the title, Nature in the City, I never thought that I'm going to get that many varieties of trees, a scientific name. And it even, I think, when I read the jamun trees, I only heard about the jamun tree. I went to the Google and, you know, just searched about. So actually, it was a really immense kind of thing. And especially, I think one of the important thing I feel is the number of people, different kinds of people who came and participated in the movement to save the thing. And especially, you talked about an elderly lady who was a poor lady. Like, she actually went to the office and, you know, she knocked the door and she... Then, you know, actually reading all those things is really very encouraging for us also, because we always pass by all these roads and we never do anything, and we never knew this dimension of the nature in the city. And again, the street vendors especially, I felt. like how important it is for them to be placed under a particular tree. Mm-hmm. And you know, they see that tree as their second home. And when the tree is not there, what is their feeling? And that's again, you know, takes my concern about, you know, like, and especially I think overall, this particular reading has really enhanced a lot of things. And you know, like what we can do, like, you know, that always we see a lot of subjects, research questions comes in our mind, but this has given a real very, very diverse perspective of the nature in the city. Thanks a lot for that. And yeah, and one more part was that insects. You talked about a lot about insects in that. I think I would like everybody to read about that. It was really interesting, like how, you know, like for us, insects is, you know, okay, malaria or dengue, or we see from that perspective. So it was very good. Maybe, yeah, apart from all the compliments, maybe one question or, you know, doubt in my mind is that, there is now I think in Bangalore we really have a good diversity of the trees, and you know that, then what about, like, we talk about the problem of water, then how sustainable will be, you know, to continue with this water problem and the health and the trees over here. So that's the only doubt I had. Otherwise I really enjoyed reading it. Thanks a lot. Yeah.
Thank you. I always find it very interesting to see what different people pick up from the book, because everybody picks up something, you know, very, very different, which resonates. The trees and the, so a big part of our health challenges is this whole lake chain being disrupted and the water system being disrupted. And there's a lot we can still do just by cleaning up our lake chains and removing the encroachments. But so much of that is political will, and you know, it's really a very hard task. The garbage crisis and the water crisis, I think, are going to be our biggest challenges. There have been calculations that we can be water sustainable if we harvest all our water and restore our lakes and wells. But when will that happen? Will that happen? I don't know. I'll give short answers.
My question is very short. Are we looking at the role of land records? Because in a lot of cases, the commons that you're talking about, they're described as wastelands or another main. And so the protection that these lands have as lakes or wetlands, that's completely gone. And I mean, I'm bringing in my experience because I've grown up in Calcutta, and the wetlands in Calcutta have been a very important part. But now more and more we see that because they're not reflected in their value, in the official records or something. Yeah. So that is another way that whatever basic ecological services are there, they're getting eroded. So is that something that, an initiative that we can take on this?
We need to. So the thing we see is that they're not recorded as wastelands in Bangalore, but they're recorded as public lands. And unfortunately, there's this confusion between commons and public lands. So that's why a Gundutop or a lake can become, you know, a school, or a park can become a Bangalore One center, or, you know, some kind of recreational thing, or being given to a college or whatever. You know, so there's this sense of replaceability. It can be some public utility versus nature, which really does not work. And I'll have to give you a longer answer on that later sometime, though. There are much more, many more intricacies.
Thanks. A quick question is, you didn't speak about the drainage. You mentioned the Hebbal Valley, but we often hear about this Raja Kaluways, and I suspect some such thing is going on here, right in front of our nose. So do you have ecological perspective of the wetlands and the drainage?
Yes, and again, could not get into that. So all these lakes, there's an intricate system. It's lake, it's wetland, it's the Raja Kaluways. And the lake didn't have a fixed boundary. It was always seasonal. Most of our lakes were seasonal, some were perennial. So the seasonal lakes, what happened is the wetland would grow at some particular time of the year, and the lake would grow and claim the wetland at certain other times of the year. So this wetland was really a commons, where if you look at the land records to link that question, you would say that this community can grow ragi at this time of the year, that community can take fish from this time of the year, this community can, you know, do some other things, activities. And that entire system then cleaned up the sewage. So the first thing we have is we have too much sewage. The second thing is when we clean up, you know, apartments and all this domestic use, and they let the treated water back into these, you have flooding because the Kaluways are blocked and there's too much water entering the system. So these lakes have become perennial. We've changed the ecology. The third thing which you have done, which is very stupid, but it's the way in which the administrative system functions in which colonial system that we've inherited, is this mapping of lake and non-lake. So there is a physical boundary, there's a survey, here's your lake, here's your chain link fence. Outside that, some 50 meters, now it's 90 meters, you can't construct anything. Beyond that, you can do whatever you want. Valleys are only sensitive zones, and many of these lakes, Kaikondali Lake is facing this, there's dumping with debris and there's construction upstream, and a PIL is not working because the BDA can give you permission to build in a sensitive zone. And the BDA gives you permission often. So once it's given you permission, there's nothing you can do. So it's, yeah, we don't have a sense of ecology when we make these.
Good morning, ma'am, for the wonderful information provided to us in this morning. My question is that what was the drive that has driven you to write this kind of books? Because most of the people have been thinking about the smart cities, something which innovation involves in the cities. But you have come up with a different dimension of nature in the city. Means what was the drive that has driven you to write this book?
I think many people look at nature in the city, but, you know, it's not that...
But they will speak, means they will be thinking that this should be done in nature, to preserve nature. But it is something in a, like an initiative, first initiative to write a book on nature, that most of the people will be get some information regarding the nature, we just preserve it. Means what was the drive which...
I think part of it is just background, no? Always special. The way in which you look at a city is shaped by who you are. Being an ecologist, I will always look at a city through nature. But it's also, I should say, personal backgrounds. And Bangalore is a unique city. So the city that I grew up in and the kind of, you know, if you looked at my neighbors, my relatives, everybody always had this very deep connection with nature. I don't think, it's very difficult for an entire older generation, if you talk to them, to separate nature from the, their way of they, them looking at the city. It's now that it's really changed a lot.
Morning, ma'am. I want to ask a question regarding, you already mentioned like the past, present and future of the city in the same book itself. So since you're also mentioning like the rate of urbanization is that much faster, so do you have a model ecologically smart plan, a model city plan that can be mooted for the general public?
No, we need to work towards that. But I don't think we can have a plan. The problem is that, I mean, even in Bangalore, as you see, the West is different from the East, and you need basically a plan that takes into account local adaptations, what local needs are, which is why I come back to the commons every time. That you should have the flexibility really for people in that area to really decide what they want. And somehow for that to be networked to a larger development of do's and don'ts. So.
Yes. I don't have a question, but I want to say something. First of all, thanks for this extraordinary and lecture. So I'm from Ahmedabad. So I'm very happy to know that in the Bangalore, there is activism still exists about environmentalism or tree or lakes or no. In my city, Ahmedabad, there are so many environmental issues regarding lake, regarding tree cutting all. There is no activism. So in the riverfront project, about 1 lakh people got displaced. So before riverfront project, they used to do some livelihood, like they used to do some farming, agriculture and all. So they got displaced, and now the government has built the platform and they call riverfront. So there is a situation of, there's a difference between two cities, that is. So
there was a World Bank report I just saw yesterday, which talks about how private partnership is very important and successful in changing cities, and this riverfront project is cited as a very good example of how people were resettled and given good areas otherwise, and this riverfront has been reclaimed. Yeah, you know what, you're very right. This the way in which we portray development and restoration is a big problem. Those of you who are interested, quiz quickly in the book, there are 3 copies in the library, so you can go and take them and read them.